Hi, everybody. Good to see you. We took a little break from this during the summer, and I am delighted to be back. And I'm extra delighted to have our special guest, Blake Simpson, who is the Senior Vice President for Global Communications for, we're not supposed to have favorites, but I know that Under Armour is a fan favorite with our Edelman team, and in large part because of, quite frankly, Blake, and I haven't had a chance to tell you this, the direction, the guidance, the support, the partnership that the team feels that they have with you and our team. And so let me publicly thank you for that. And we're just pleased to be able to have a conversation with you today. So welcome, Blake, and welcome to everybody. And thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me.
We started... you know, we've been doing all this research because it's important for us to be able to substantiate all the counsel that we give to clients like you, Blake, with research. And so our most recent bit of research is the future of corporate communications. And I think we have seen in the past almost 2 years now, this remarkable shift in the role that people like you play in terms of driving significant change. And I'm going to talk about the looks like 9 key elements that came from our research. And it's a simultaneous way for me to be able to share what we found and also get your reaction to it. And before I do, if you will share, because this is not your first trip to the rodeo, you have been with some of the most iconic brands and done some of the most remarkable work in the industry. So tell our guest a little bit about yourself, and then I'm going to talk about the research.
Yeah, no, again, thank you so much for having me. And the feeling is absolutely mutual with my partnership with the Edelman, my Edelman family, and they really are family here. We have been in the trenches in truly an unprecedented period of time, right? So my background has always been in comms, but it definitely has varied. I started my career externally in broadcast journalism with NBC Network with the Today Show, Nightly News, CNBC, and then sort of found my way into politics, doing speech writing during Mayor Bloomberg's time, and then decided I was done with the East Coast and all that cold, went back to my roots on the West Coast, and that's when I sort of really started to understand the power of communications and how it can transcend, whether you're doing it externally or internally. So I shifted and moved internally into Gap Inc., right, big retail brand, and sort of cut my teeth there, learning how to continue telling the right type of stories to completely different audiences, both internal and external. Being in San Francisco, it's inevitable that you're going to bounce around between tech and retail. So I did that for a little bit. Again, very interesting because the business models are different. Right? The actual products are completely different, but the consistency and the common thread of making sure that you're connecting the work that's being done to the people who need to understand why remains the same. I took one sort of left turn and went into food and beverage, which was absolutely insane, but in the coolest way. I think it's what pushed my creativity like to its limit because it's so fast moving. And then, you know, got this call from Under Armour and I'm back in retail, but in performance, which has always been on my bucket list. I was a collegiate athlete, and to come to Under Armour at this time in the brand's journey has been probably one of the greatest gifts of my career.
That is lovely. And, your background explains why the partnership is so rich and the change that you've been able to drive at Under Armour is so evident, I think, because of your varied background. Let me go with the first point and just give me your reaction to it. Key findings. One, the role of communications has become more materially important to CEOs, boards, and the C-suite. 46% of CCOs surveyed now report to the CEO, and you and I have been in this business long enough to know that that wasn't always the case, compared to even 34% in 2014. Why do you think that is so materially important, just the reporting structure?
Yeah, I think it's critical. And I think that shift has happened because of the responsibility that has now shifted to CEOs of major corporations by mm-hmm. society and by consumers. Mm-hmm. They're holding brands to a much higher standard. And in doing that, they're holding the CEO to a much higher standard, and there's a lot more accountability. And to have that direct line of contact with your communications leader becomes critical.
Yeah. And we see that in all of the CEOs and all the companies that have done really well in what I call this period of tremendous growth through turmoil. Mm-hmm. The responsibility, the expectation of CEOs, and to have someone like you right there next to them to advise has been critical. Second finding, the modern corporate communications function is agile, multidisciplinary, and insights driven. 89% ranked functional organization in their top five areas of internal investment for the coming year. Have you seen that change in Under Armour? And again, what's the difference that it has made?
Oh, absolutely seen that change. And the difference that it's made is it's actually helped to connect the work that everyone's doing and driving everyone towards the same path forward, right? Mm-hmm. Showing how, I think for a lot of brands, all the different functions have always done some component of this work, but it's been, that word siloed, or it's been, it's been specific to their function. To now have everybody responsible for putting their work and the effort into the same lane actually makes it a lot more powerful. But more importantly, it actually shows both internally the employees, we call our employees teammates, but then also externally the consumer, they can feel it at whatever touch point they're entering our brand. And right. Our employees can really understand how their work is impacting this much greater purpose. And I think it's giving a better sense of empowerment, a better yes. sense of responsibility, and definitely a better sense of pride.
Yeah, there's the efficiency piece of it.
Absolutely.
Oh my God, it just makes it, and when everyone is so pressed for time and so pressed for space, the efficiency, and it just makes it much more interesting. And it builds you call them teammates, it builds this camaraderie among your team that we're all working towards the same goal, but we have different ways to contribute to it.
Yeah, I'll add to that one more thing that I think that what was critical to Under Armour achieving that was the fact that when Patrick came in, he had such a laser focused clarity on how we needed to identify as a brand. Our mission was clear, our vision was clear, and what he brought into that conversation as well was our purpose, to empower those to strive for more. And when you have that level of clarity, everyone in the company can understand the role that they play in achieving that purpose. And that purpose becomes a guiding point in every single conversation that you do, in every single project that you're about to start, in every single brainstorm that you're going to engage in. How is what we're talking about today supporting our purpose?
Yeah, and what's your role in that? I remember Oscar Munoz at United saying that when he came in, he was very clear, all of you play a role in making our customer experience fantastic. So whether you are organizing the food or cleaning the plane or flying the plane, but everybody is clear that this is what we're driving toward and they understand their role in it. Three, comms tech will usher in a new era and communicators will use it to deliver quantifiable value to the business. 70% report comms tech as a top area of investment for the coming year. What's your reaction to that? That surprised me, if I'm honest with you.
Oh, it 100% surprised me when I saw it. But then when I thought about it, I was like, my team has been having these conversations with me because we're not just our brand, but as a society, we're very data driven now. Right. You know, that catchphrase of data over opinion. And I thought back to when I worked in tech, right? And tech is rooted in data. So that was their starting point. it was almost like other businesses and other industries had to start catching up, and they always had data and they used data, but they didn't necessarily speak to the data and speak to how it was informing decisions and how it was informing, you know, conversations and communications the same way. I think we're getting just a little bit sharper with that and a little bit closer to that. And so it's making comms tech become a much bigger conversation. It's one that we're definitely leveraging in within our business, because as a performance brand, we really do use the data for everything. And so why wouldn't we use it in comms as well?
Right. Why wouldn't you integrate it there? And I think also, as this period of disinformation and misinformation that we are living in, it gives you confidence, and it's so much more clean when you can say, look, you cannot dispute the data. Some people will dispute the data. If it's, you know, your thing says Blake Simpson, somebody might say it doesn't say Blake. And I'm like, it does, but okay, I'll move on. But I do think that that's one of the things that it just makes it so much more clean, and it gives you the confidence that you need to make decisions. All right, number four. The increased focus on the workplace, workforce, and well-being of employees isn't a pandemic fad. 62% report an increased focus on employee communications. I know that's your jam, so.
I mean, that actually made me so happy, right? It is like just, I'm like, finally, everyone else is coming along. You know, I think that one of the things that this pandemic and everything else that happened during the pandemic has done is really allowed companies and given companies permission to do more with their internal teammates. You know, maybe they wanted to before, but traditionally you had a certain amount that you pushed externally, a certain amount of things you did internally, everything else. And that has definitely shifted. And I think that a lot of companies probably wanted to do more all along, and now they have permission and they're not turning back. With regard to mental health, I think the other thing that's interesting is that conversation, again, right or wrong, what's happened with athletes all over the world, how vocal they've been. You know, Simone Biles literally opened the floodgates on the biggest stage this summer to give permission for the conversation around mental health to be acceptable. And so when that's happening externally, when that's happening like almost every single day, it then empowers companies to open up that conversation more broadly, I think, with their internal population. We've done a really, I think, amazing job with that. You know, the ELT, our executive team, recognizing it, and then our HR team really diving deep. We've had like these days of understanding where we bring in specialists from all different areas of mental health to talk about things and to open up to a safe space. We've provided additional days of mental health where you can, you know, take the day to do what you need to do,
right.
To sort of reset and refocus. And then I also think that leaders across our business, and I know across others, when I talk to my peers, have been empowered to support their teams in whatever way they need. Because also the thing, you know, comms teams were at the forefront of everything since day one. We have not had a chance to breathe at all. And there were other, you know, other functions that maybe because of what's happening in the world, they were actually stopped for a period of time. And so different functions within businesses are probably at different stages of mental stress and mental fatigue.
Where the comms tech data point surprised me, this one, like you, made my heart soar, because it was a recognition that our most important asset are our people. Mm-hmm. And we have to put our people first, and we have to communicate with them more effectively as well. And, you know, and this focus on mental health is something that is such a long time coming. And you're right, athletes should be applauded, because they are representing the interests, though, of everyday people who are dealing with a lot of these things. So we at Edelman, in recognition of Mental Health Awareness Month, are closing our offices on Friday. so that people can have that day. And whatever you need to do might be different from what I need to do, but it is a recognition that I want you to pay attention to this. I want you to pay attention to yourself, and we should do it together as a group.
We're doing the same thing on Friday, and I'm so proud about that.
Yeah, I'm proud of both of us. I'm proud of both of us. Number five, expectations around social issues have shifted the leadership agenda, and stakeholders are holding companies accountable. I mean, we were in the thick of it with you guys on all of this. 73% report that these issues have shifted their communications agenda. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, I think I actually applaud that statistic. You know, I think it's about time that consumers have started to realize that where they have the most power, you know, outside of voting, is with their pocketbook.
Yes.
And you know, you can make a phone call to the 1-800 customer service number and list your complaint, which is what happened a lot of times in the past. But the power is in the purse. And I think that that has probably been what woke a lot of companies up to realizing they had to like actually put action behind their words, right? It wasn't enough to say you were going to do something. It was actually showing how you were going to do it, identify those milestones, check in, because people are paying attention. People are also, I think, realizing that they have the power to go anywhere for things that they need. And so if you want their loyalty, right, and you want their business, they want to make sure that you are actually firing on all areas of society that matter to them, right? Yeah. It's because they feel like you can. And you should. I think that, you know, I think that a lot of companies, like if I think back in my past and stuff, got away with doing just enough or just being on the surface for a really long time. And what was interesting to me was to see a lot of those companies get called out in the past 18 months in a really big way, both internally and externally.
Yes.
And, and then for other companies that were just starting to enter that conversation, like Under Armour, we were able to thankfully sort of take the right steps that made sense for our brand to do things the right way, so that we could actually sustain what we want to do and reach our goals.
Yeah, and I have to applaud you all for the way you have done that too. My daughter just moved to Baltimore, and so I'm in Baltimore pretty frequently, and to see the impact that Under Armour has had in that community and the commitment to that community, because our research has also said to us, yes, you can talk about societal issues, but you have to earn the right to have that conversation about other things, about having your own community. Like, how dare you talk about what's happening in the nation if you don't talk about where you live? And you all have done a beautiful, beautiful job of that. And I now personally appreciate it and recognize it, although I've admired it from afar. Six, a modern organizational structure only gets you so far. 43% now report a centralized structure compared to 26% matrix and 31% decentralized. So this is like the future. This is the way we are putting things together. And what do you think are the challenges? This seems logical, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, a modern organizational structure only gets you so far, but what are the other things that you have to do besides having the structure in place?
You know, I think it's interesting. I think that the thing that happens if you swing the pendulum too far in any one direction is you start to lose that connectivity that we talked about earlier.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
And I think that is what should be the driving factor in making some of those decisions on structure. You know, you want to allow for flexibility. You want to allow for development and growth so that you know, you don't have that high turnover. But in creating, you know, too much of a matrix or staying too centralized, you run the risk of creating isolation. And it can look different in those two models. And so it's like, the most important thing for me is when I think about it, when I think about looking at how organizations are thinking about being set up, are you setting yourself up in the best way possible for your business, not only to run efficiently, but to also make sure that you're keeping everyone connected and allowing them to truly understand like all of the things that matter across the entire enterprise versus just their little area of business.
Yeah. So I feel like that one is easier said than done.
100%.
You know, it's easier said than done. In theory, yes, absolutely. What are some practical things? We always like for these to be, for people to walk out of this and say, oh my God, Blake and Lisa are so interesting and cool. But also for them to walk away with some concrete sort of examples or assets so that they can do these things in their own organization. So what are some concrete examples that you can think about that you can share with our listeners?
Well, you know, I think one of the things I'll say, because you just brought up easier said than done. I mean, if it was as easy as the statistic that came out, you know, you wouldn't have reorgs. So
Right. Just at a basic level.
So there's always some fine tuning and some stuff that happens, and the way that a business is moving also impacts sort of the decision to set up. I think that for comms, what I have found is when you have an organization that's set up that does have sort of that blend, you have your center, but you also have sort of these matrix structures within the business. Usually for me, I find it because it's within other functions within the enterprise. So think like supply chain and finance and some of these other groups. But then if you're a global brand, you also have the regions, which then have their own subset of central matrix somehow connected. And so when I talk to my comms teams in these situations, and I've been in them pretty much in all of my companies, but sitting at the center, I tell them, I'm like, we are responsible for creating the template and the framework for the brand that can be pulled through the entire enterprise, but then can be lifted and leveraged, you know, within the regions, because the regions do have responsibility and a little bit of autonomy because it's regional and they need to be able to have the flexibility to make those nuances and those changes that will make sense for their audience. But at the core, which is what I was talking about with that common thread, it's really important that everything that's being shared and disseminated throughout the company at least is consistently the same at the center, at the root.
Yeah, I think that is, and you touched on when you were a global organization and markets are different and communities are different and talent is different. But I do think people are looking for fundamentally, these are our values.
Yes.
This is what we're working towards. This is what we believe in. But you have to have the flexibility and the autonomy to a degree to sort of execute in a way that makes sense for your individual group at this particular time.
Yeah. And the one thing I'll add to that too is that different parts of the business are probably they're all at different stages. That's what makes the business complex, right? So you could be, you know, like all of a sudden struggling in your APAC region and on fire in EMEA, and they have different needs. But to your point, at the core, like they understand the purpose, you know, like anchoring to your values, the baseline of the strategy that we are trying to execute as a brand, how you then have to adjust that to what is happening within your region, to where you are in your business. You have to allow them the flexibility to do that, because it's not all the same really at any point in time.
Right. Number seven, by the way, for those people who I'm annoying with my glasses going back and forth, because my team tells me that all the time, my apologies, but I can't help it. Number seven, communicators are increasingly acting as change agents, enabling ongoing transformation. 77% report that business transformation has impacted their communications agenda. This is one of my favorites.
Yeah, I mean, it absolutely has. And it's impacted it in a way I think to the benefit of comms functions, right? It's about having that seat at the table at the very beginning,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I think that's one of the biggest changes that I've seen over the last 18 months, to be quite honest with you. And that probably has a lot to do with the shift of having more direct responsibility to the CEO and stuff. But for a real long time, comms would get pulled in sort of at the end to just push that button, get it across the wire, get the emails out to the employees. And now, you know, we're being pulled in when they're just starting to think about the discussion they want to have, because right. There is a true value in making sure if you're going through this transformation that you're putting a lot of thought and consideration into all of the steps and what all of these different decisions are going, how they're going to impact and result in what's next. Yeah. And that's where comms actually has the most power, is we have the ability to really see and understand, you know, how a decision up front, what that ripple effect will look like through the business. And we're also doing that because we know what the calendar is of how the yeah. business wants to speak and get out both externally and internally. We are like the secret spies internally, right? We actually hear everything that's going on with our teammates. So we can help, you know, inform up front if we're actually brought in early. And so I think that like seeing that role and responsibility shift in transformation conversations has been really interesting to me, but for all the right reasons.
Yeah, I think for me, I co-sign everything you said, but it's also just been interesting because so many times comms people are brought in and you look at it because, you know, we're problem solvers and we end up saying, you don't have a comms problem. You have an operational problem.
Yes.
Structural problem. You have a workforce problem. You actually have a real, now I can help you to communicate what the resolution is, but the resolution and the solution is something that we should contribute to. And very yeah. often you see comms leading it. And once you get down the path, you're like, time out.
Yeah.
The problem is not what to say. The problem is what you are doing or really? Not doing in many cases. Yeah. So I think that is incredibly exciting. Number eight, the lines between communications and marketing continue to blur, creating both challenges and opportunities. 65% of CCOs rank marketing communications in their top five areas of increased agency partner investment for the coming year. Look, you've been in so many places and your background is so varied. But that comms marketing thing is interesting. And I think it presents more opportunity than it does challenges. But we would both be naive to not acknowledge the challenges. And sometimes we go like this.
Yeah, it's forever a challenge. What I think has helped to clarify a little bit and create a little bit more clarity in that rub that you always have. And it's a good friction, right?
Yeah.
Because it fosters the conversations that you need to sort of check yourself to make sure that you're still being authentic and true. But I think going back to this idea of putting action behind the words, mm-hmm. right? That's definitely helped, I think, move and elevate like marketing communications now. And that's where traditional comms can help, right? And so it's not enough just to like throw that ad out there or throw that creative out there. You can no longer do that. So the marketing functions have had to definitely open up their conversations more broadly to include the action that needs to be taken and actually like the why behind that, right? It's right. You know, really, really showing the public, showing consumers, showing our teammates that we took the time to really understand what is going on in society and what we can do to help and to affect change in a way that is authentic to who we are as a brand and allows us to do it in a really honest way. And I think right. that has been the biggest shift that I've seen throughout my career, and most importantly here at this point in time with Under Armour, is that idea of really holding yourself accountable with action
mm-hmm.
to the marketing that you're actually pushing out there.
Yeah. And you know, the other thing, it's action, but it's also ramifications and repercussions if you yeah. don't. I think that's one of the things that we totally have to remember in any conversation when we're talking about trying to drive change internally or externally. It's hollow, it's vacuous, unless you say, but if you don't, this is what happens and this is what this means. And that takes bravery and that takes boldness, and not everybody has that.
Yeah, no, I if I can take 1 minute just to give you a good example of that. You know, when I first joined the company, I joined the week that everything shut down for COVID. Mm. And at that time, you know, we had our societal issues with George Floyd and Ahmaud Arbery and other things. And as a brand, we were really trying to understand what we needed to do, what we should be doing, how to do it, because it was a first for this brand. Your Edelman team knows this very well. And I'll never forget the conversation that I had with Patrick and with the ELT, you know, where we talked about the fact that we have our five values, and one of them is stand for equality. And that has been there since the beginning of Under Armour. And we have the, we have the right, we have the responsibility to stand up that value, as well as our other four, you know, love athletes, act sustainably, celebrate the wins, and fight on together. But at this point in time, standing for equality was what we anchored all of our work in. It's what we anchored all of our action towards. And it allowed us to enter the conversation in a really authentic way, I think in a really powerful way. You know, it wasn't necessarily, we weren't the brand saying, here's $150 million here for this, and here's $200 million for that. But you know what? We stood up a Run to Vote initiative.
Yes.
With bipartisan, right? That was recognized nationally, that just informed people at the most basic level on how to register to vote.
Right. Because you went to your core values. You didn't stray outside of that. You went to your core values. So, A, we needed an hour for this conversation because it's fantastic. But because I'm neurotic, I have to do number 9. You can see the notes where they're telling us to wrap. Number 9, in an increasingly complex and activist multi-stakeholder world, the corporate brand matters now more than ever. 63% of CCOs say brand and corporate identity is something your team is responsible for. 51% ranked corporate positioning in their top 5 areas of strategic importance. Everything that you've said, everything that you do, that you've done previously and at Under Armour supports this last statement. So we'll let that be the last comment we have here. I am so excited to do more work with you, and I am grateful for your partnership. And everyone, I'm sorry we went a little bit over, but thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Bye-bye.